some values. Do you have values?
Yes!
If I have this much money, I will want this much. If there is no full stop, do you understand?
Yes.
If you keep looking at someone else and saying, oh my God, that person has more, then you will feel unhappy. To be happy, you have to be happy with what you have. Who will explain the second one? Yeah, explain.
If you do hard work, you can do anything. If you are lazy, you cannot do anything.
So you have to work very hard. And values, you have to follow all the time. Even when there is difficulty.
Sonu, I heard you teaching the class all about values today. Tell us a little bit about that. I mean, what were you, telling them? How does one go about defining values to such young kids?
I must confess, Tarun has already, the class teacher,
that's right,
had done this work with them. And instead of teaching maths or grammar, which I didn't feel comfortable, I felt more at ease teaching a subject like that. So I was just revising with them. This wasn't something original I did with them.
But do you enjoy coming down to the classrooms and interacting with the young kids?
No, not at all. I dread it. I'm not good with teaching young children.
Right.
I can teach adults pretty well. I do training programs. But my grandchildren's teaching, I'm miles away from my own children. I don't think I have the patience to teach young children.
It takes a lot, doesn't it?
It takes a lot from me.
Well, a lot of good work, though, is being done by the Teach for India fellows. You've been instrumental in bringing the entire concept to India. You've been part of it from the beginning.
Part of it.
So tell us, you know, what it's all about
or
you feel it's significant in...
Sure. I remember about 4 years ago, our current CEO, Shaheen Mistry, said she had heard about Teach for America. And she was very excited. And as she explained it to me, I became very excited. And I thought good teaching could bridge the inequity gap, education, the opportunity to enjoy learning, the opportunity to have good teachers. This is a luxury in India, which is a pity, because this is a basic necessity. And even in private schools, it's not done very well. But on top of it, the children are beaten, humiliated, learning by rote, learning
right
by heart. So they are passing exams. I don't think they're getting educated. And I've seen the classroom. You have come to the school. You've seen a class taken by a regular teacher where there's pin drop silence. The teacher is involved in her own work. And you've seen the classes where the fellows are. I think it just speaks for itself.
So I'm going to come back to that a little bit more in a moment, but just on a lighter note, what were you like in school? How were you as a student? A great student? Were you naughty? Did you give the teachers a hard time?
I was a naughty student.
You were?
But a very good student. I was the head girl of the school.
Okay.
And very popular with my teachers and students.
Okay.
Which was a rare combination.
Yeah.
But I think the teachers liked my open naughtiness rather than slyly doing things, by and large.
So you were one of the favorites then?
I was quite favorite of
them. So give us an example of how you troubled them. Any incident that comes to mind?
Of course, imitating. I was quite good at imitating them. So quietly imitating the teachers. Or once the whole class decided that we'll put gum on the seat of the teacher.
No.
And she wasn't even an unpopular teacher. I don't know what made us do that. Or if I take an incident from the college days, we used to have Jesuit priests coming in who didn't know anything about our custom. And in those days, they used to wear those cassock. And some of us told the Jesuit priests for the college concert that you have to perform the traditional Indian dance, and we made him do the hijra dance. And this father, no. with his cassock doing this dance, till the principal would say, cut it, enough, you know, things like that.
That's terrible. Okay, it sounds like a lot of fun. What are some of the, you know, apart from memories, the life lessons that stayed with you really from those early days, from school, from college?
I think one of the very important lessons was that education, the genuine good education which some of our teachers could give us, makes learning so much fun, you know. And we had a good teacher, we had relatively good teachers, and some of the values which we learnt also, of reaching out, of being honest. We did cheat a couple of times, I have. But through that, what is it that you learn? So the way they taught us, the consequence, rather than punitively come very harsh on us. So I think it taught us a lifetime lesson that taking such shortcuts and getting good marks is not good for our own selves. So I think the values, the ability to question things, I think these were, and I went to a school which had Gujarati and English as a medium.
Okay.
So I didn't learn English well, but I realized we were rooted in Indian culture. Unlike many convents, I learned Indian dancing.
Right.
And some of my cousins who studied in convents found everything wrong with India and have moved to America. Whereas I found that at my school, I had a lot of empathy for something that was going wrong.
Okay.
And what can I do to make it right, rather than leaving the country as if that's the solution.
So did you stay back for college as well?
Yes, yes, I've stayed here. I was in St. Xavier's and then
right.
Tata Institute.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's right.
Yeah.
And your daughter as well, did she also study here?
She studied here till her 10th standard. Then she did her A-level in England and went to Imperial College to do her master's in chemical engineering.
That because she wanted to go overseas? So.
No, I mean, in my days, there was no such opportunity offered to me, except when I finished Tata Institute, I was offered a scholarship to East-West Center in Hawaii,
right.
but I opted to get married.
Hawaii?
Yeah, but I opted to get married.
Do you ever look back and think, oh, maybe I should have gone?
99% no. But if I've had a bitter quarrel with my husband, then maybe I could have thought that. Why did I get married so soon? But 99% no.
No.
Because I did get a Fulbright scholarship soon after I was married, and I went for 4 months for higher studies.
All right, well, that's a little bit of Anu's school memories, but we're going to come back and talk more to her about how she's really spreading that message of education even more nowadays. Let's come back to that in just a moment.